question to ask it again, and we'll get that taken care of at the end. My name is Jay Keck. I'm the Habitat Education Manager for South Carolina Wildlife Federation. And again, I will admit I know about things with wings, but those things also have feathers. So I'm a big bird guy, but I just do not know my bats. So again, I'll be learning alongside with y'all. So please ask questions. I've already asked her, you know, Jennifer, a bunch of other questions, you know, just chatting with her today, but, y'all ask questions. It makes it fun for the presenter. And it engages everybody, and you're probably going to ask a question that others have. So just ask those, and I'll again interrupt Jennifer as we, you know, go through the presentation. So this is Jennifer Kindel, and she works for South Carolina Department of Natural Resources. I did confirm that she prefers being called Bat Lady more than Bat Girl. So just so y'all know, if you ever see her out in public. But I just reached out to her not too long ago, you know, this spring, to ask her if she would do this for us, and she agreed to graciously. And I appreciate you, and I'm excited to learn more about bats. So go ahead with the presentation and tell us a little bit about yourself, Jennifer.
Awesome. Thanks, Jay. It's really great to be able to give bat presentations. It's one of my favorite things to do. Talking about bats is just, it's so fun and exciting. My name's Jennifer. I'm the statewide bat biologist for South Carolina DNR. Grew up in Oregon, got super into birds, came over to South Carolina. My dog's gonna bark. he's very excited too. It turns out if you can catch birds in mist nets, you can also catch bats in mist nets. And so basically ended up moving over to bats because I thought they were super fascinating, and have been working on them for about, with DNR for about 6 years after having done a little bit of bat work, bird work with DNR. So it's been a fun adventure going from birds to bats, because obviously they're very different, but flying is a pretty fascinating thing to be able to do. So with that, let me close my door real quick here. Got a very protective dog in this house. Okay, this is a raffinesque big-eared bat that's flying up here on the screen, and that's a state endangered bat here in South Carolina. So you'll hear a little bit more about that. Well, let's go ahead and get started. I'm hoping that by the end of the talk today, you'll have learned exactly how fascinating bats are, how they benefit us, and all the things they're harmed by in terms of myths, fear, and white nose syndrome, and many other things as well that I won't get into all of them today. That can lead to very depressing talks. So we will also be talking about how you can help, which is a lot of fun. I'm gonna start out today with just one slide from the how you can help in the beginning here, because we've been having a lot of calls from the public about bats in buildings. This is the time of year that they have pups. And so they're in large colonies, large-ish colonies, in bat boxes, sometimes in attics, sometimes in places you might not want them. And so people are trying to exclude bats, some people and some wildlife control operators. In fact, we have wildlife control operators that know better that are still excluding bats from houses right now, which is not humane because the pups cannot fly. So let me tell you what exclusion is. It's when you put up a device where bats enter and exit that allows the adults to leave, allows the ones that can fly to leave, so they can't get back in your house. And so it's a good way to get rid of them from the house without having to, you know, hurt them. But right now the pups can't fly. And so that means they end up starving wherever they're at. Sometimes it can be in the walls or wherever the bats are. So just know that, if you have a bat problem, or if you know of someone who has a bat problem, which is they want to get rid of them, as long as everyone's safe, there's no human health concern, as in the bat is not in your living space. If you can wait for the bats to be able to fly, that's going to help you and the bats quite a bit, because you won't have, you know, dead pups in your walls, which nobody wants anyway. So please let people know that, and please be aware of the wildlife control operators you use. Unfortunately, they are not certified or monitored in South Carolina, so you really have to be careful about using a good one. And with that, let's jump into the different bats of the world. I'd like to touch on that real quick. There's a really cool video that I'm going to show you here that's got pictures of bat faces. It's got some music you can't really hear, so don't worry about it, but let's go on to that. So I like to talk about conservation in this talk quite a bit. And so there are various organizations that do conservation, and Bat Conservation International is one of many. So we can talk more about other ones as well, but they all do really good work for bats. So worldwide, there are over 1,400 species of bats, which is pretty impressive. They make up 25% of the world's mammals. They are the only flying one. Of course, you've got flying squirrels that actually just glide. So they're pretty fascinating in that, right? And one of the other really amazing things is that they can live for a really long time in the wild for their size. So they can live up to 30 years or more in the wild. So if you've got a mouse that lives 5 to 7 years in comparison size-wise, it is really impressive. And they've got some really mysterious and fantastic things going on to be able to live that long. They are part of the order Chiroptera, which means hand wing. And you can see in this picture, all the fingers that are in a wing of a bat. That top little hook up here is the thumb. I don't know if you can see my mouse, probably not, but it has a points to the thumb there. And then you've got all the other fingers, first, second, third, fourth, fifth. So you can just imagine it, that's how they fly. They are super, super maneuverable. They can do some crazy things that birds cannot in terms of gleaning insects off the ground and doing all these really amazing things in the sky. When you're seeing a bat flying and it looks like they just don't know how to fly because it's really erratic, they're actually catching insects while they're flying, right? And then they're also just into their mouth. They're also able to scoop up insects from the wing membrane of near the tail. And they pop insects in their mouth while they're flying and like doing somersaults while they're eating and catching and going on to the next one. So it's really fascinating. If you get a chance to see a video on that, seeing them catch insects in slow motion, it's really cool. So given so many species in the world, they vary quite a bit from 6 inches in wingspan for the smallest one, the Kitty's hognose bat. And also, by the way, never pick up a bat with your bare hands. This is just a picture. But the largest actually has 6-foot wingspan for a golden crowned flying fox. So yes, there is a thing called a flying fox and it exists and it's amazing. They're so big and so cool. And they do really, really great things for us, like pollinate plants and things like that. So that's what I want to talk about in this slide. So worldwide, bats provide a lot for us, as well as contribute to their ecosystems, of course. So they pollinate things like the plant agave. So if you like tequila, you can thank bats. If you like bananas, you can thank bats. They spread the seeds of things like chocolate, black pepper, very important. And then they also protect things like coffee and cotton, rice, corn, like some really important crops. So they'll eat insects that tend to destroy those crops. So we really depend on them and don't even know it worldwide. In South Carolina, we've got 14 different species, which people can be surprised by. Everybody thinks maybe there's just one or two, but we do have 14 across the state. I like to group them into two different sections, the ones that roost in colonies and the ones that roost solitarily, like tree bats. And those are the ones that are the 5 that roost alone are called tree bats. The ones that roost in colonies use things like caves, tree hollows, structures like buildings, bat boxes, that kind of thing. In these pictures you see here, there's a tree hollow that's got all these Raffinus big-eared bats in it. And all you can see really are the light going through the little ears, but that's a nice little colony of Raffinus big-eared bats using that tree. So the five that roost alone, as I mentioned, are the tree bats. They tend to be more colorful, yellow bats, red bats, and I'll show you in a second a little more pictures on those guys. But these are pictures of bats being in using Spanish moss, which is really cool. I've never seen one hanging on a Spanish moss, but now that you know, you're gonna have to look. They also hang out in leaves, just in trees. They could actually also be under leaf litter in the fall. So they'll be on the ground under leaf litter, and then in palm fronds. So, you know, it's a good reason to keep those dead palm frond bits on your palms down on the coast there, because the bats love that stuff. So I wanted to introduce you to each of the species. We've got four species here in the Myotis genus, which are part of the colonial roosting group. We've got the northern long-eared bat, which is the federally threatened bat that we have in the state right now. It is likely going to be listed as endangered by the end of the year, largely due to white nose syndrome. Right now it's listed as threatened. We've got a little brown bat that is pretty rare in our state, but has been found here, that's also hit by white nose syndrome. Eastern small-footed bat, also hit by white nose syndrome, but not as bad. I'll go into that later. Southeastern bat is more on the southern portion of the state. Coastal bat. The rest of these colonial roosters are bats you will see more commonly. The Brazilian free-tailed bat is a bat that uses bat boxes and houses. Evening bat and big brown bat do the same thing. And Brazilian free-tailed and big brown like to hang out in the same boxes, which is pretty cool. Raffinesse big-eared is our state endangered bat you saw in the beginning there. Really crazy ears, right? Like, so nuts. They really need to see hibernating, because when they're hibernating, they curl them back like ram's horns. So it's just really cool. Tricolor bat is another one that gets hit by white nose syndrome, that it used to be a common bat, but has been declining pretty rapidly as well, unfortunately. The rest of these guys are tree bats. Like I said, more colorful. Tree bats aren't hit by white nose syndrome, but they can carry it, carry the fungus that causes it. Northern yellow bat, this picture doesn't do it justice. It can be yellow, which is really cool. It's fairly rare to capture. It's a very, very coastal bat, so we don't capture them very often, but when we do, we get real excited. And they're huge too. They're one of the biggest bats that we have in the state. Seminole bat's also a coastal bat. Eastern red bat is one of the most common. If you see a bat flying around, it's either probably an eastern red bat or a big brown bat. Really beautiful. They can be brick red to light, sort of almost yellow color, depending on if it's male or female. The hoary bat has many colors for a bat, and is beautiful and one of the largest as well. And then you've got the silver-haired bat, which of course has these 90s like tips on the ends that are silver hair. So really beautiful bats. And these pictures are from Merlin Tuttle's Bat Conservation. Why are bats so fascinating? They do so many cool things. I cannot even tell you about all of them, but we'll start with echolocation, of course. That is super fascinating. They've got this unique echolocation ability that is literally thousands of times more efficient than any other system built by humans. So they can ID and capture insects in flight. They can glean them from leaves and things like that. Some of these bats are really, like I said, maneuverable, so they can really get in there and get insects and avoid a lot of the tree clutter and things like that. Most of our bats don't migrate in South Carolina. They're fairly resident. We find them all over the state, all year round, generally. Silver hair bat is the only one that does migrate. So we don't have them around as much in the summer. Hoary bat is a species we have here, but it does tend to migrate in more northern portions of its range, as well as some other species. Hibernation, of course, is really fascinating too. Even between the 14 species we have here, they do different things. So the tree bats go into a shallow torpor, or sometimes a deep torpor if it gets really cold, and they don't hibernate for really long periods of time. Part of what's so cool about that is that the tree bats have this furry tail membrane that they basically use as a blanket and wrap themselves up in when it gets cold, which is so cute and really cool. And then there's these other species that don't have that furry wing membrane that tend to be true hibernators. So the eastern small-footed bat hibernates for as little as 4 months, where our tricolored bat hibernates for as long as 7 months in the northern portion of their range. So really depends on the species we're talking about. And hibernation length really does play a part in whiteness syndrome as well. So we'll talk about that later. Bats eat a ton of insects and lots of different kinds, depending on the species. You can see this big brown bat has this huge jaw. He really gets a lot of those beetles. The little brown bat over here eats a lot of mosquitoes, 150 in 10 minutes. A colony of 30,000 southeastern bats can eat up to 50 tons of insects a year, which includes quite a few mosquitoes, given that they're a coastal bat. And 150 big brown bats can eat up 1.5 million pests per year as well. That same little brown bat species can eat 9 species of mosquitoes that carry West Nile virus. A lactating female Brazilian free-tailed bat can eat 2/3 of her body weight in a night. And that same 150 big brown bats can prevent 33 million larvae from hatching. So they do a ton to suppress insect populations. So bats are fascinating in their own right. And as a biologist, I feel like they don't need a dollar sign associated with how cool they are, but people like to know that too. So someone's done a study on that. And they do provide a pest suppression service to our ag industry, totaling $115 million every year in South Carolina alone. This is an average estimate. So an average of $23 billion in the US every year for the ag industry. So no small number, really helps us out. And in doing that, it reduces the need for pesticides. So you're spraying less pesticide on the landscape, hopefully having less harmful cascading effects for other wildlife and things like that. So really beneficial to us in a lot of ways. I also like to dispel myths, because there are a ton of myths out there about bats getting stuck in your hair, which of course they don't, and various other things. So. First one is bats are not flying mice. They are more closely related to humans than they are to birds or to mice, as you can kind of tell with those, that hand wing. Bats do have eyes, so they're not blind and they use those eyes. They also consume a lot of what we consider pests for crops. Bats themselves do not chew on wood, so you don't have to worry about them chewing through anything. They use those teeth to eat insects. So there's that. So rabies is a big one. I definitely talk to folks about. Rabies is a disease that is very serious, so you always treat it with respect. It can be deadly. However, bats are not the biggest carrier of rabies. Less than 1% of bat populations carry it. However, there's a caveat here. People do contract rabies from bats more than other mammals. And when I say that, it's about 2 people in the US per year. So why do you think that could be? And I think it's probably that people are not aware of the risks of bats. People are more likely to encounter bats if they get in their house. People are more likely to pick up a bat than they would pick up a rabid raccoon. And so there are other things playing a part here on why bats, people contract rabies from bats more than other creatures, but it is not because they are riddled with rabies or tons of other diseases, because unfortunately they get a bad rap for that and are really sort of a scapegoat for pretty much anything that comes up sometimes in the news. It's like, bats so dirty, but really there are other factors. It is important to contact DHEC, however. If you find a bat in your house, like in your living space, you need to just check out the DHEC website. I put some text up here that's a little small, but to try to fit it in. But there are 3 main things you need to understand about exposures to bats. If you find that one of these 3 things has happened, it's important to call DHEC and save the bat. So that means like safely isolate the bat so it can be tested for rabies. Well, unfortunately, a lot of people want to get it out immediately, and then you can't test it to see if it had rabies, which means if there was a potential exposure, you might have to have a rabies post-exposure vaccine for no reason, just to be extra safe, and that's expensive and a whole deal. So if you haven't been potentially exposed to bat, great, you can let it go. You know, it might want to contact DHEC anyway, just to be sure. But yeah, you need to be able to test that bat for rabies. And if it had, did not have rabies, then great, you're good to go. So just be aware of that. If you've either, if someone's touched one outside, or if you have one in your living space, just be careful. With rabies, is nothing to mess with. So COVID-19 played a pretty big, do we have any questions?
Just real quick. You get rabies just by touching a bat, or do you have to be bitten or scratched, or?
Yeah, not by touching a bat, but, and this is not in my experience, but people report that they could be bit by a bat and not know it. And that's why if there's one, you wake up to one in your room, it could have landed on you and bit you without you knowing, kind of thing. In my experience, they bite and you can feel it. So if you're just touching a bat, you know, it's risky because you don't know if they, you know, they quickly bit you or something sometimes, I guess. DHEC wants people to be extra safe. But touching the fur of a bat is not going to give you rabies.
Sure. Okay. Just wanted to.
Yeah. Good question.
And you were talking about those removal technicians or you know, the companies out there that can remove bats for you. And you were talking about how to do it in a safe way for those pups. Do you have any recommendations in our state?
I unfortunately can't recommend companies because it's a preference. I can't have a preference for which companies are better than other companies. Gotcha. So DNR has a list of wildlife control operators.
Okay.
They ask anybody to send them their information, but we don't verify that they're any good. So it's just a list that you kind of have to shop around and basically know what you're getting into before you call them. Like, you know, if they say, yeah, we can get rid of them right now, then you know that's a bad one because they're not mentioning the pups, or they're not saying, hey, if you can wait just until, you know, August, then we can get them out humanely. So,
okay.
Good question though. I wish, hopefully someday we can permit wildlife control operators. But.
Sure. No, that's okay. Well, let me know if you can, because I know that's something that we will get calls on. And just a quick question here. The question is, there's more rabies from bats in the U.S. than dogs?
I don't know. So I guess more rabies is kind of a vague term. So you can get the records of people getting rabies come from bats more than anything else, because people are more likely to, you know, pick up a bat that might be sick. In terms of how prevalent rabies is in bats versus dogs, I don't know. Is that the question?
It might be. I think, you know, that was a good explanation either way.
Yeah. And then it's a good point. Before rabies prevention and had really come into full swing, I think in the 60s, the two per year is from the 60s to present day. Before then, there were a lot more rabies issues from pets. But people have been really good since then getting their pets vaccinated.
Yeah. No, that's what I figured. Okay. All right. Well, I appreciate it. And I'm going to disappear again.
Yeah. Great. No, it's good to take a little break. I go really fast.
All right.
Cool. Yeah. So COVID-19 obviously has controlled our life for the past few years. And especially in the beginning, there was a ton of fear around where it came from, and as well as a lot of other things. So unfortunately, bats got a really bad rap when it came to COVID-19. You cannot catch COVID-19 from a bat. The disease itself is from humans, not from wildlife. The origins of the virus are still unclear. We still don't know where exactly it came from and the process of how it spread to humans. I think at one point there was a study that looked at genetic similarities between the virus with a horseshoe bat, and it was like 97% similar. But if you understand and know about genetics, that's really not a smoking gun. It's similar, but not the same. It's just like us and chimpanzees. So there is no direct connection. So bats and other wildlife are natural hosts to other kinds of coronaviruses, but don't harm us. And of course, there are many viruses out there, but it's just important to know that you can't get it from a bat. However, bats do have really fascinating immune systems. And so if you get a chance to look into that, that's like a whole nother talk. There is something to do with the fact that they fly that really contributes to their ability to deal with viruses in their bodies. And because of this, they might hold amazing breakthrough vaccines for things. And basically, if we could better understand the immune system of bats in a way that would benefit us, it would be a crazy breakthrough. So bats are really important for that as well. How does COVID-19 threaten bats? Because we know we're not threatened by bats with COVID-19, but they have had a huge problem with public fear in general, but especially with COVID-19 and other things as well. I think someone mentioned monkeypox the other day and bats, and I was like, no, no connection. But like anything that's kind of crazy and scary, people are like, was it bats? Was it bats? I'm like, no. So you really have to be careful about pointing your finger at things that people tend to do. So fear and misinformation really led to a lot of killing of bats across the world. Especially in the beginning, where there were hundreds of people that were trying to burn bats. In Cuba, colonies of bats were being exterminated. And in India, 150 bats were killed. And so like bats are just being killed all over the place because people are afraid. And there was, some news about, ooh, maybe it could have come from a bat. And that's all you need to hear before people are like, let's kill them all. So that's a really huge conservation concern. Our question as researchers is, can we spread the virus to our bats? Our bats are already suffering from the loss of habitat, from white nose syndrome, from disturbance, from a lot of other things. Pesticides, it's a whole nother conversation. So we wanna make sure that we're not spreading the virus to our bats, North America. The USGS and Fish and Wildlife Service did a risk assessment and said, okay, if for a little while there, they said, don't touch bats until we know more, don't survey them, don't do anything. And then since then they said, okay, wear proper protection equipment, like COVID-19 or a KN95 mask so that we're not spreading the virus to our bats. So that's what we're doing now. We already wear, when we go into and survey for hibernacula, we already wear Tyvek and gloves and things so we don't spread the fungus of white nose. So now we're just adding a mask as well, so we don't spread anything else to them. But more research on the virus and our bats in North America is being conducted right now, so we can learn more about which, if any, could be affected by it. So I like to show this little video next. Again, it's got a little bit of sound, but it's really not necessary about are bats really that scary? There's a few more of these cute little videos that kind of put things into perspective in terms of how scary bats really are. All right, white nose syndrome. I've mentioned a few times at this point. You've probably heard about it, but if not, it is a disease that has been killing bats since 2006 in the United States and North America. Over 6 million bats have been killed. That was an estimate from years ago, and they're working on another estimate, but basically it's a disease that is caused by a fungus that grows on the bats while they're hibernating, infects their skin, and wakes them up so that they end up starving to death because they've burned up all their energy reserves that they needed for hibernation. But how serious is 6 million? So we really don't know how many bats we have. Being nocturnal and a flying creature, they are incredibly difficult to monitor, turns out. So it's really hard to know what that means, except that we have a way of taking a snapshot of those populations in the winter when they're hibernating, go into a hibernacula. You know, we don't wake them up. We just, and we're wearing all our gear, but we just go in there and we count them and identify the species. And in that way, we've seen a tenfold decrease in the number of bats hibernating in North America at those locations. So significant local extinctions have resulted, unfortunately. A little brown bat, a study looked at how, when they might go extinct by, and they said 2026. So this is one of the species that's being looked at by the Fish and Wildlife Service in terms of listing. Eastern small-footed bat had huge declines initially, but they are actually not doing as bad as other species at this point. So might have something to do with the fact that they like to hide out in crevices instead of collect together and potentially spread the fungal spores. But unfortunately, the northern long-eared bat is the one that's been hit the hardest in, because it has up to 100% mortality from white nose syndrome. So this is kind of a busy map, but it is a map of where the fungus and white nose syndrome has been found. The cooler colors are where it was found initially, and then the warmer colors is where it's been spreading recently. So it's, you know, spreading south and west. Oregon doesn't have it yet, but Washington, California, all the rest, they have it over there already as well. 12 species can die from this disease. 5 of those are in South Carolina, and are the highlighted ones are in white there. Can be found on 7 other species that aren't hit by this disease, but can carry the spores. So the eastern red bat doesn't suffer from it, but can move it around, unfortunately. So in South Carolina, white nose syndrome was found in 2013, and the pink counties are where bats have been found dying from the disease. The orange ones are where we found the fungus, but bats did not seem to be suffering from it. And we're not sure what that means. I feel like over time, we'll see if that means that they're surviving or it was just a slower decline. But this is where it's been found. In the gray is where we've tested but not yet found the disease or the fungus. So that's 10 counties. Richland County is the furthest south. There are 5 species affected. Northern long-eared and tricolored are 2 of those that are hit really hard and being looked at by the Fish and Wildlife Service. To be listed. Tricolored bat may very well be listed as federally threatened or endangered as well. The northern long-eared bat is super fascinating species because we in the past have known them to only be in the upstate in the mountains. And then North Carolina found them on their coastline and we're like, And then we, I should say, Palmetto Bluff Conservancy down in Beaufort County found the first northern long-eared bat on the coast in 2016. So ever since then, we've been trying to learn more about what's going on with that species down there, because it's very different habitat, as you can imagine. But unfortunately, they do seem to be gone from the upstate. So I feel like they've been extirpated from the northern portions of the range in South Carolina, which is a common theme for much of their range, except for the coast. So coast could be a place where they survive white nose syndrome, we hope, because of the amount of insects available, the amount, you know, the fact that it doesn't get real cold. There aren't a lot of caves in South Carolina, period, but especially not on the coast. There's a few limestone ones, but nothing like they have in the northern portions of their range. So they might not hibernate for really long periods of time, which would be great in terms of white nose syndrome, and they have other things to eat. So we have some hope there. The tricolored bat is a statewide bat that has been hit by white nose as well. We had some of the largest numbers, 400 bats hibernating in the Stump House Tunnel in Oconee Pickens, in the upstate, in the Blue Ridge. I'm gonna say it's Oconee County. Anyway, they got down to 7 bats a couple years ago, but did not go out completely. They are back up to 19 bats. So it's a slow potential recovery, but we're just monitoring it to see. They only have a few pups a year, so it's a very slow process, but we're hopeful that maybe they can, but we really don't know yet. Yes.
I don't know if you're gonna answer this, but how long does it last? Like once they have it, how long does it persist for?
Yeah. Well, they suffer from it mostly through the winter season, but as soon as they are done hibernating, their bodies can take care of it, like deal with it while they're awake and not hibernating. So okay. if the ones that can survive, there are some that do survive and actually are coming back to the same hibernacula that we know are positive and are surviving. So that's positive news, but then they will get through it and then be fine for this the rest of the year and then might get it again during the winter.
Gotcha. And then let's see, white nose syndrome. I think the question just left me. Doggone it, I forgot it. But I'm gonna get it back to you in just a little bit. All right.
Okay, sounds good. So someone was calculating recently in a paper this year what we've lost from that, besides our bats and a lot of the ecosystem services they provide, in terms of the value lost is between 426 to 495 million per year for the Eastern USA in terms of agriculture. So that is a big deal too, obviously. It's all connected. So these things are gonna happen, unfortunately. And this was a little image put together by our friends in Canada. So I had to put it up here. All right. I feel like it's time for a little breather from all this white nose talk and negative things. But here's a picture of a Brazilian free-tail bat. It's super cute. Depending on if it's like with those little Chihuahua dogs, either you think they're really cute or they're really ugly. But I think these guys are pretty cute. They are, this guy specifically, this species is the fastest flying animal on the planet, which is a big thing to claim, but they fly straight line, flapping flight speed at about 100 miles per hour. We've got peregrine falcons that dive at 200, which is really impressive. But for flapping flight straight line speed, Brazilian free-tailed bats are currently recorded as the winner. I keep waiting for the bird people to come out with some research study showing one of those flying faster, but we're hanging on to it for now. So these guys are the ones that are in buildings a lot, and unfortunately people think are pests, so they have no idea they have the fastest flying animal in their attic. So pretty cool. All right, so jumping in on what you can do for bats. If you like to go in caves and mines, please, well, mines, I don't know how many people go in mines, but we do because we don't have a lot of caves and we have to monitor bats in old mines. But entering them in the winter, if you're not, you know, researching them, is discouraged because you might wake them up. And you might also spread the fungal spores. And unless you have some Tyvek handy and want to do all the decon we do, it's good not to do that. If you're a caver and still like to go to these places another time of the year, it's good to decontaminate your gear so that you're not spreading the fungal spores to different sites. And these fungal spores are so tough from white nose syndrome, they will survive years and years and years in an office setting, for example. So you can take it in the summer and accidentally spread it to another spot where it will grow in the winter. And of course, handling bats, don't do it. It's bad for you and it's bad for bats. It's bad news if news gets out about someone getting rabies from a bat. It just ends up spreading a lot more public fear. So don't handle bats. There are resources and links to DHEC if you want to wear gloves and do it the right way. If you need to get a bat out of your house, if you know you don't need to send it to DHEC for testing, using a box and various things where you're not actually touching the bat. So there are resources for that if you need to. Bat boxes, I love to talk about, but I always have to start with, please do not create a place where bats will die on accident. So you don't want to create an ecological trap. So you need to do your research on what a good bat box is. The issue with bat boxes is that bats can overheat, and they're actually still doing research on bat boxes and the best ones for bats because of this issue. But there are multiple types of bat boxes. They really need to be big enough and have more than one chamber. So the rocket box is really the best. It's the fanciest box that there is out there for bats. And it's basically a box within a box in the box where the bats can move through all the boxes and also move to different sides of the box. So if the sun is beating down on one side, they can scoot over to another side if it's too hot. The multi-chamber boxes are also really good. They're the ones you see more commonly. And this is a, on the right side is a picture of looking up into the bat boxes. You've got two back to back, which is really good for temperature control. And then they can choose one side or the other too, if they need to. You can see a little bat squeezing up in there. And in some of those four chamber boxes, you can get 300 bats. They really like to squeeze up in there. And it's a similar issue when if it does get too hot, the pups can fall out and they can't fly. So you really need to monitor your bat boxes as well and make sure that everything's going well every year. Temperature fluctuations do play a part even in some of the best placement of boxes. So once in a while, you might have a really hot year and it's just, you might have problems with bats then. But if you can find a place that's generally best for them, that's great. The boxes need to be about 12 to 14 feet high. So not on a tree. It's really tempting to put them on a tree, but snakes, raccoons, squirrels, whatever wants a bat's neck can totally just climb the tree and grab a bat's neck. So we recommend putting on poles or posts away from trees because you don't want too much shade. For bat boxes in the upstate, we recommend 6 hours of sun during the day. On the coast, I'm more tempted to recommend 4 hours because it can get so toasty. These bat boxes definitely need to have vents. So the research tested designs are really important. Don't just buy a random box online. Sometimes they're too small, sometimes they don't have the vents. So take a look there. There are designs you can make yourself or find people that make them to buy from. Bat Conservation International and Merlin Tuttle's Bat Conservation have great websites for that. If you have a bat box that you want to count bats and report back to us on what you got, that would be great. We have a citizen science project called SC Bat Watch, where you count bats emerging from boxes in the evening. And it's really pretty enjoyable in terms of surveys. You bring out a camp chair, you bring out a cold beverage, you watch the sunset, and then the bats just come out of the boxes and you just estimate them best you can. Put it in the app that we have, the Survey123 app that's free, or you can write it on a regular paper data sheet and send it to me. But we generally try to get counts of before the pups fly and after the pups are flying. So different, just two times during the summer, early, like late spring and late summer. This is a video, I don't know if you can see it, but the bats coming out of these boxes. It can be tough to count them, so you have to estimate best you can. Sometimes you use clickers or apps that act as clickers to try to estimate the bats coming out. These are boxes at Sunrift Adventures in Traveler's Rest. If you ever get a chance and you're in Traveler's Rest and then over an evening, you know, after like having a nice meal at a restaurant, come sit not far from these boxes and you'll be able to see bats coming out in the, at sunset. It's really cool.
Does DNR ask for the specific species?
Great question. If you know it, yes. It is difficult to identify species for sure. So one of the things we do, sometimes if you have a bat box, you know, there, especially if you have hundreds of bats, every once in a while, there'll be a bat that dies. And you can take a picture of one of those and send it to me and I can identify what you've got. We also have what are called echo meter touches, which are a little device you could plug into your phone and it will record bat calls and identify bats by the calls, which is really cool. It's not super accurate, but I do have that device that I've been meaning to try to find a way to check out to people because they can record bat calls and then send them to me and I can take a closer look to see if there's what species they might be.
Okay.
The other thing too is if you're recording your bats in specific areas that are where more sensitive bat species are, that's really interesting and I might be coming out to check. To see what you have, because sometimes we've got records of little brown bats, for example, in the Blue Ridge Eco Region in upstate. So, yes, so that's the tough part is identifying. But we do have resources on our bat SC Bat Watch webpage that has descriptions of each bat. So if you do see one on the ground and you're not touching it, you want to take a picture, send it to me. Or then you got to bury it too. That's a whole other thing. But anyway,
Well, yes. the device that you were talking about, I can't remember if you said it was on your phone or not, but whatever device records that would be good to know. So whenever afterwards, just send me an email if you would with those types of resources, and we'll send a recording of this webinar to these folks, and we'll include those types of things. But I know, as a bird guy, they sing, they have different colors. I was born and raised in South Carolina. Every single bat I've ever seen flying looks just like the first one I ever saw. They all look the same. So
it's true.
There's really no way, like, watching them fly to really get a good idea on a bat, huh?
Yeah, it's tough. So if you get a really good picture, a really good view, the only one that's easy-ish to tell is the Brazilian free tail bat. And I didn't really explain that, but the free tail means its tail extends past the wing membrane. So if you can see the tail sticking out, it's a Brazilian free tail bat.
Okay.
if it looks red, sometimes if you happen to be walking around with a spotlight like I do, you can spotlight a bat. You can see the red color. Okay. But yeah.
Okay. We'll let you know when we have bats and you can come over. Okay.
Okay. Sounds good. All right. You can also volunteer for DNR. We do lots of surveys statewide, and being non-game funded, we rely on grants and volunteers to survey all the bats across the entire state. So we have a lot of partners and people that do that, and it's fantastic. So we do winter surveys, spring and summer surveys, and I'll just jump into that right now. I think I don't want to take up too much time here. I've just got so much to talk about. Culvert surveys, road culverts. It's crazy, but bats use road culverts. And in the last few years, we've been surveying those to look for hibernating bats, since we don't have caves. It turns out we have a ton of human-made caves all across the state that bats use. We've been partnering with the Southeast Aquatic Resources folks, who already survey culverts to see if they are an obstruction to aquatic resources. So you can see in this double box culvert, aquatic organisms cannot get through that. So we're recording information for them and recording information about bats that we find, and they're doing the same for us. So it's a really great partnership. They can say like, hey, there are bats in this one, come check it out, tell us what we got. And then we've been, contributing a lot of data for them as well. So bats like that tricolored bat, they can either be hanging on the ceiling, or like the silver-haired bat squeezed in between a crevice in a culvert. Some other culverts look more like caves, like these corrugated ones, that are not necessarily under major highways. But the picture on the top here is showing a culvert that's pretty old. It's under a highway on I-26, actually south of Columbia. And we found this third largest colony. The amazing technicians, Maria and Caitlin found over 200 tricolored bats in this triple box culvert. So we've been driving over this culvert for years, had no idea that there was a huge population of hibernating bats in this culvert until this past year. So we are currently working with DOT, because obviously this culvert needs to be replaced. There's this widening project happening on I-26. We want to help these bats, but obviously things need to be repaired. So that is brand new thing for us that we're working on conservation wise. So more pictures of tricolored bats there as well. Summer netting and tracking of bats is pretty fun. We haven't been taking volunteers for that the last few years because of COVID, but would like to start doing it again. Having people help set up these mist nets that if you've ever captured birds, it's the same idea. And record information, and you can see bats up close. It's really cool. So this is kind of what that looks like, that process. And we clean everything off in between each bat to help prevent the spread of spores, et cetera. That northern long-eared bat there has a transmitter on it in the middle. It's a very small transmitter that we put on that's less than 5% of the body weight of the bat, and track them to roosts. We track northern long-eared bats on the coast to these really cool longleaf pine ecosystems where they're roosting under sloughing bark. And using the same areas that managers are managing for red cockaded woodpeckers. So we have hope that management is also helping northern long-eared bats as well on our coastline. We would like to know more about the burning timing, how it goes with the pups timing. Bats can move around with their pups, which is good. So they're a little more flexible than birds in terms of like cavities that they have to be using. Anyway, so we hope to learn more about that and make sure that the burning timing is okay for the bats as well. We got really excited about our first coastal maternity colony that we found last year of northern long-eared bats. It was 11 bats coming out of this dead snag that were emerging at sunset, which is pretty good for northern long-eared bat colony size. And I don't know if you can see the bat on the left-hand side under that piece of bark. I was taking pictures. I didn't see it at the time, but I was just zooming in, hoping I'd get some pictures of a bat. And in this picture, you can see that one there, but there's also noses and forearms below it as well with all the other bats in that spot. Pretty fun and exciting things. If you haven't heard of it, we are participating in the North American Bat Monitoring Program, which is obviously nationwide, North America actually. And it involves recording bat calls. It's a really efficient way to monitor bats without having to set up nets. So when we do netting, it is set up nets, run nets for 5 hours after sunset, checking nets every 10 minutes. So it's a lot of work. But when you're recording bat calls, especially with partners across the state, you set out a device, it records calls for a week. You bring it back in, you identify the calls. Identifying calls can be tricky because they're gonna take a while, but a lot of expertise. But anyway, that's what this program does. These are randomized grits and cells across the state where people are assisting with these surveys. So lots of partners that depend on, and this stuff depends on volunteers.
How do you get that device? Is that something that if you want to volunteer, you'll receive a device?
Exactly. And it's just, we only have so many. So what happens is the surveyor, I'll let this video play while I talk here, but we have devices, we'll meet up with you for that week. So you set it out for that 1 week every year, and then we'll pick it back up and take it to the next set of volunteers. And so the technician starts on the southern part of the state, and there's different sections for different weeks, and there's 9 weeks total. So the first week she'll go here, give all the stuff to people, bring it back in, go to the next section. So she ends up going up the state doing that.
Okay.
So you can, with the protocols and everything, you learn how it works. There are lots of different devices out there. We happen to use the Anabat Swift, which is from a company called Titley. There are many other devices out there that record bat calls. And with this program, you set out stationary or you run mobile acoustic routes, which is really where we need the volunteer help. You have this mic suction cup to the top of your car. It's connected to the device. You can hear the bat calls while you're driving. And then you'll give everything back to us, including the data, and we'll go through it and let you know what you recorded by the end of the year, basically. And then it's long-term. So we've been doing it since 2015, which is crazy for a long-term project in a non-game species. So we're really proud. And we are also one of the first states to take this on. So it started with Dr. Susan Loeb in Clemson and her grad student. And between Clemson and DNR, we've really been keeping it running, as well as all the 50 volunteers that assist with this. So let me know if you want to help. Supporting public lands and conservation organizations is another huge things you can do for bats. I mentioned the conservation organizations a few times already. Save Lucy campaign is another good one, and there are others as well. But they do a lot of work to help support bats worldwide. I mean, habitat is a really huge piece of it too, when I say supporting public lands, because habitat protection and wildlife conservation are critical for wild animals and for ourselves. Doing so really keeps both humans and wildlife in general healthier and safer. So when we're talking about COVID, you know, originally was a habitat and habitat encroachment and wildlife abuse kind of situation. So providing those wild places for animals and conserving bats and other animals is really important for everybody. Educating others, of course, is a huge piece of all of this, is teaching people not to be afraid and learn to tell them to learn more. You know, I'm trying to say May through July, pups can't fly, so don't exclude them. I'm just trying to let people know about that kind of stuff. We also have Bat Week, which is a really exciting time to learn more about bats and share in the love of bats. You can learn more about that at batweek.org. We also have a South Carolina Bat Week at the same time. We usually get the governor to sign a proclamation for us for Bat Week. You can join us at the South Carolina Bat Working Group. We have a little group that we've been trying to, sort of fledgling still, trying to build up and see what we can do for bats across the state. We really get involved in education during Bat Week, so that's been a lot of fun. We do have a meeting every year. Not sure if it's going to be virtual or in person. If it is in person, it'll be in Columbia, probably. So keep that in mind. In conclusion, I hopefully you've learned about how fascinating bats are, how they benefit us, and how serious fear and myths and white nose is for bats. But there are plenty of things you can do to help, including educating others. So I just want to thank all partners and volunteers that have put thousands of hours of time into partnering with us to survey bats across the state and learn more about them. And thank yous for the pictures and videos from the conservation organizations. And yeah, if you want to join us, join our Bat Working Group page and listserv. And I generally try to put out volunteer opportunities out on that. And yeah, we do a lot of fun stuff for Bat Week. So feel free to join us on that.
I think something that I learned today, and it should be on your checklist, is how cute bats are. Did you learn?
Thank you. Yes, I should totally put that on there. I
had no idea that I was going to fall in love with bats today. We do have, if only they would sing. We do have a bunch of questions. Real quick, an easy one. How much do those recording devices cost on your head? And obviously people can Google that if you don't know off the top
of your head. I want to say a few hundred. Okay. Maybe 200 for there's a couple different levels.
Sure. Just Google it. I'm sure it's easy to find out. Christina said in Charleston County Parks, they just got one of those devices. They are looking forward to testing it out. We have one question. The human ear, can the human ear always hear bats? We see them at dusk, but never hear them.
Yes, great question. Generally, those calls, the search phase calls, which are what they're looking for insects, and social calls, those are generally above our human hearing. But they do make noises that you can hear, like lower level noises. When we capture them, they are very noisy. They're like, what are you doing? They make a lot of noise that way. But sometimes you can hear them in the box as well when they're talking to each other. So they can do quite the range. Most of it is above human hearing.
Do they all sound relatively similar between species, or is it something where you can figure out which one's which?
It's different. Yeah. So with the acoustic devices and the programs they have out there, that's how you can tell the difference, is they at different frequencies and different shapes of the call. It's pretty cool. And then even when we're handling them, you can tell the sound of a big brown versus an evening versus some others just by the tones of their call, of their noises.
Yeah, awesome. We have a question. Out of the 14 species, how many are in the upstate? Do you know?
Ooh, yes. I would say probably 12. Northern yellow bats. Honestly, it might be 13 at this point. Some of the ranges have been extending northward. I'd probably say 13 of the 14.
Okay.
And honestly, for the coastline, the only one that's on the coast is the Eastern small-footed bat. So probably about 13 on the coast as well. And then missing a few. But
there's not like an area in South Carolina that only has like 5 out of the 14 bats.
Even the Midlands have a pretty good number of bats.
And I wanted to talk about this too. You know, we have a question that says, aside from bat boxes, are there any other waste that homeowners can create habitat. You know, I mean, you know, we're always talking about native plants for birds because of the caterpillars and other insects that those native plants support. If I'm a bat, I would imagine I love to eat moths. And I know you had, you know, a picture of some caterpillars and moths. Are y'all, you know, bat folks, are y'all really pushing native plants? You know, brush piles, you know, you were talking about leaf litter. Do brush piles support them? Like what are really simple things on our property, whether you have a, you know, a 20th of an acre or 500 acres, what can we do that's real easy besides putting up bat boxes?
Yeah, I mean, water is a big one. If it's at all possible to have a pond, that's great because again, it provides more insects as well, which might not be something you want, but for the bats. But also drinking water. Yeah, any plants, any native plants really that bring in nocturnal insects, bats would love. So yeah, like you said, with moths and things like that. But yeah, I think providing, you know, if you've got snags you don't mind keeping, that's great. Snags are great for so many things anyway. So they will definitely use those. Having a variety of habitats, having some open habitats, depending on how much property you have, having some open habitats, having some with that aren't, you know, the diversity of habitat types is good too.
Yeah. Okay. No, that's, and you know, I know you went right over the whole pesticide talk, you mentioned it, but if you can reduce or totally eliminate, you know, pesticides on your property and that'll help them out as well.
It really does. I mean, bats bioaccumulate chemicals just like many other animals do. And not a lot of studies have been done on bats in long-term, especially with pesticides. So basically if you're spraying for pesticides, you're killing the natural predator of the things you're trying to kill. So if you could avoid it and bring in bats instead, it saves you a lot of money and it saves the environment as well.
One thing I was kind of curious about, you know, for birds, we can buy, I love pitching bird friendly coffee, the Birds and Beans coffee. And you were talking about all the, fruit, I think, or you know, some of the agricultural, you know, products that we buy that bats pollinate, but, is there anything like that for bats? Like, can we support a certain type of, you know, chocolate or support a type of, you know, a banana farm, you know, that supports bats?
Honestly, that's a great idea. I don't know of any specifically, but it might be worth looking at the conservation pages for the bigger conservation organizations. I could totally see them doing something like that. I know they have at least the, you know, adopt a bat stuff where you can adopt a bat and then I think you get a certificate or something, but that money goes towards protecting bats in general.
And I would imagine any farms that use less pesticides would be better for bats. So if you know, if the chocolate that you buy or the, you know, bananas that you buy are organic, I don't know, but I'm assuming that they are better for not just bats, but other wildlife too.
Yeah, definitely. Anything that's, yeah, not using pesticides, great.
All right. I'm going through all my questions that I had and the ones there. Hey, where did the white spores or the spores come from anyways? That was the question.
Ooh. Yes. They actually came from Europe. Okay. And so white nose syndrome and the fungus has been over there for a long time, it turns out, and their bats have figured it out. So, but this is over like long periods of time, like before humans were really causing problems with habitat loss, et cetera. So, they've noticed that their bats don't group as much as ours do. And that might be from that, getting through that white nose syndrome situation. So we don't really know exactly how it got here. It likely came from a caver who like totally didn't know that, you know, about why nobody knew about it, about white nose syndrome, and might've come over to a New York cave and just got it, spread it that way on accident.
Okay. I figured it was something that was introduced, but all right. So we'll go from the white nose and end with tequila. Somebody just wrote tequila in capital letters. So I guess what they're saying, this is our friend Zach Steinhauser, the Purple Martin guy. But I guess what he's saying with that is, you know, buy organic tequila if you can.
That's right.
And somebody did want to know, where can they send a picture of bats that they have in their barn from the past winter? Is there a place that they can send those to?
Yeah, you can just email them to me.
There you go.
DNR. Yeah, you put that in there. Actually, I'll just type in real quick.
It's at the bottom right there. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. Nice.
Yeah.
All right. And then there was one in the the little bat in the video. I guess it was the one before the back bat week slide. Is that the one that had the tail that you were talking about?
Yeah, the Brazilian free-tailed is the boy, the cute one. But it doesn't really show the free tail, unfortunately, in the picture.
Okay.
But yeah, this one.
All right.
Yes, that would be helpful. Google Brazilian free-tailed bat.
Look, it looks like a little puppy dog.
It does. It really does.
Who knew? Who knew bats were cute? Anything else that you want to say about, you know, what folks can do, anything else about bats before everybody heads back to work?
I think the big thing is just educate others. I mean, that's the big thing that, like, hard to find funding to educate. So a lot of it is just, word of mouth and joining, you know, the bat working group and just getting people to know more about how amazing bats are. And if you're scared, it's just because you haven't learned enough yet. So.
Yeah. And again, we're recording this, so we'll pop it on our YouTube channel. We'll send it to all the participants today. I'll send you a copy. And then I'll